community. And we were discussing that when at school, kids are usually separated into, you know, the good folks and the bad folks. And I was like, hey, man, you got a startup and you played in a band. You definitely were the bad guy. And he gave me a look and was like, you know, it was a folk band, Marina. I was a good guy. Anyways, you went from classical music and classical music education to startup world. How did it happen?
Yeah, well, I think the bad guys and kickers can be also the good people. The good girls and good boys. I definitely was one of the good girls, but I was also very much a rebel, criticizing everything. I was planning to become the minister of education when I was, I think, 12 or something, because I wanted to change the system. And I just realized the other day that's actually what I'm trying to do now as an entrepreneur. Well, also the background is, you know, I was my father was in a rock band, but my grandmother took me to all the symphony orchestra concerts. So that's also some sort of a rebellion in that, and just going between boxes and fields in whatever you're doing, and not conforming to something that is set, preset for you. And well, why did I take the route of entrepreneurship? Actually, the story is, I don't know how common it is, but it's a bit of a... Basically, I was studying at the Royal Academy of Music in London, and I was practicing musician there for 2 or 3 years. And then I, you know, at the time, Iceland economy was booming. So if anyone wanted, if there was a family, someone related to me who died, they flew me from London to Iceland to sing in the funeral. You know, it was just like traveling between Iceland and London was like no deal, no big deal. You know, it was just like red buses, you know, the airplanes going back and forth. Then I moved back in 2006 and I had my daughter 2007 and a little bit kind of unplanned, but of course wonderful. And then I bought a flat and the flat turned out to be molded. Then we had the financial crash in 2008. And suddenly there are no red buses going back and forth to London anymore. And so my sort of plan of being based in Iceland, having an international career, you know, doing some studio recordings, et cetera, were sort of crushed. And but it was actually a very good push, because then I decided to do something maybe more, or I just had to do something more that I could see more financial, let's say, security. And then I became an entrepreneur, and then everyone was like, okay, how secure is that or safe? But I feel as an entrepreneur, I feel like, at least in my case with Mussila, it has been really, you know, step forward, step forward, step forward, always going to the good and right direction. Always moving somewhere. As a musician, you may do amazing things, but you always have to go back to point zero. Like you do a project, you're back to point zero. So for me, having a long-term project that has a growth potential, that was a new thing for me, and I really like that. Plus, I just love doing what I'm doing.
I cannot but agree about the necessity of loving what you're doing. By the way, how old is Mussila?
I founded the company with my co-founder, Hilmar Thor Birgisson, who's a computer engineer, in 2015. I had been developing the concept for 2 years prior to that. And yeah, so we are about 4 years old, turning 5 in February.
And how would you describe the current stage of the company?
I consider ourselves in a very important crossroads right now. We have been funded by the Icelandic Technology Development Grant, which has been compensated with investment in total for, I don't know, $2 million or something in total. And now we're raising funds for 1 million euros, actually, and we're quite far with that. Right now, and looking for actually a strong investor abroad to finish that round with us, that has a route to the next level. But we also have deals, a publishing deal with NetEase in China for a new platform that they're launching with educational applications, and another one with a Finnish, or from Rovio, Hatch, if you know that. And both very, very exciting opportunities for Mussila. And we launched our subscription model just this May. So we are still fine-tuning that and launching like with a big marketing campaign in a few weeks.
So definitely very exciting times for you. Good luck with that. Could you please shortly explain to our listeners what Mussila is about?
Yeah, we are Mussila Music School is our main product. And that is a curriculum-based mobile application. So you progress through skill-building challenges in music theory, set up as little courses, or which are actually small you know, like little maps that you go through for each topic, where you learn the middle C, you learn the quarter note. So from with a variety of exercises, we implement step by step the music theory and the sight reading. Then another part of the game is called play, and that's where you have similar maps and courses for each song, so you can learn it step by step. And this is a catalog that we're going to grow into a bigger one, so that you can find the song that you like and you can learn to play it. Yeah. And the third part is a creative platform, Mussila DJ, where you can create your own music and scratch like a real DJ. But the whole game is based on an adventurous setting. So there's a little storyline. This is for kids, for children. We're starting there at least, where you have these four characters that crash on this island of Mussila, and they are musicians themselves, and they know how to read music and write music. But they meet with the locals, which are the monsters of Mussila, who meet in the evenings for jam sessions. And, you know, so they teach them how to play by ear and, you know, join a band, and the other ones teach the monsters how to read music.
I should say I got fascinated by what you guys are doing some time ago when I ran into Mussila online, and that's why I was glad to meet you at Slush. Speaking of Slush, what are your plans and expectations?
Well, we started yesterday. It took off quite nicely when we actually won the Nordic Tech Awards at the Excited, which is a huge honor for all of us and my team. We are definitely looking for investors and connections, collaborators for further growth of Mussila here in Slush. This is a fantastic summit here that we have. You know, everyone is at Slush, you know, if you're in the industry. And so it's not only me who's there, the whole team, we decided to come, all of us. And for the tech people, our CTO and the programmers, they are extremely inspired to be here. They want to meet people who, you know, with the latest tech and see what's next up. And in game design and programming, and then the business, me and Jón Gunnar, our marketing director, we are meeting the investors and collaborators, and then we have also our music director, who is meeting with the musicians and people doing interesting stuff in the sounds. Yes.
And I think that was definitely a very good example for our listeners to understand that all kind of people with all kind of backgrounds can find their place in the startup world.
Yeah, I think being in a game studio is actually amazing, because you have people from such a completely different backgrounds. It's really, really interesting. This is much more fascinating than I thought myself. I was not an avid gamer. You know, I didn't play computer games when I was little. I just played music. And it's like a volcano to have explosion, to have people from such different backgrounds. And characters, and there's so much, the culture, your friends and everything, we are all adding, you know, it becomes so big, especially in Iceland, when, like, if you're in the music scene in Iceland, you know everyone in the music scene, but you may not know a single person who's a computer programmer. So this is really, really exciting thing for me.
Thank you very much for the interview.
Yeah, so I am Andy Matias, and I'm currently a planet-centric designer at Vincit. A little bit more about me personally is I'm someone who's really passionate about sustainability. This is like my kind of reason for being. And I'm from the U.S. I spent about 5 years in New York City. I was doing like film and photography there, and I kind of saw the belly of the beast of consumerism. My creative capacities were being used to kind of sell more products that people didn't really need, and helping, you know, companies to grow on unsustainable grounds. So what I'm trying to do now is to use my skills for something more meaningful.
Via photography to sustainability, and now to business, which is a spin-off of Vincit in some sense. Can you please explain a bit more about your
project? Yeah. So actually, a lot of people have some ideas about photography that are not really how I see it. I basically see myself as a sociologist with a camera. So you're observing. You're trying to kind of understand the essence of what's happening in front of you and capturing it visually. And this is something that's a skill that can be used anywhere. So when it comes to Vincit, we need to kind of understand what's the essential pieces of a business that should stay, and what can we change, and how can we kind of realign it with some needs of the planet. Yeah, so that's kind of how photography came in. But actually, in between that, I did a master's at Aalto, at the Creative Sustainability Program. And this is something I highly recommend for people who want to do startups, is to go through this program first and kind of understand what does sustainability really mean, because we can't just be doing any old startup. You know, any old idea isn't really enough anymore. It has to be the right problem. And if we're trying to kind of do like some little tweaks around the edges with a new startup that might be a little bit better, a little bit different, it might not be the right problem to choose. So this is something that we need to focus on.
Tell me a bit more about planet-centric design.
Yeah, okay. Planet-centric design is kind of like the natural evolution of design. So I'm sure you know that there's, you know, desirability, feasibility, viability. And these things can, you know, they can create amazing products and services. They can be successful. You can make some money. But they don't think about the wider impact of products. It's not really understanding, you know, what's going to be the effect if there's a million of these things. If the whole planet starts using this, what's going to happen? Where is it going to go? That kind of thing. So what planet-centric design is doing is trying to build on this and still have like profitable services by using kind of a wider lens that is like systemic, transparent, and responsible. And what we've been doing now is we're developing like a toolkit and a new methodology so that you know, when you're designing a new service or product, you can use these tools to ask those big questions that help you do like actually sustainable products and services. Yeah, that's the long and the short of it, but yeah.
I have to kind of ask why doing that, in a sense that before I stepped into the startup community, I had a feeling that big companies, and Vincit is big enough, so big companies, corporations, don't really care about nature, don't really care about what's going outside of instant money.
Yeah.
So why allowing that, why putting some resources and finance into planet-centric?
Yeah, I share some of those beliefs that, you know, companies aren't doing enough and they don't care. And a lot of times it is true. For Vince's case, I mean, the fact that we are investing some time and resources, they've hired some new people, we've been given like, you know, total access to everything Vincit has to develop some new services. So I think Vincit's on the right track. But yeah, I mean, I think companies basically are starting to realize that they don't have a choice and that consumers are demanding this. So it's the market forces are working in a way. It's slow. There's been way too long of a delay. But I think there is kind of a tipping point now where companies are saying, if I want to keep selling my thing, if I want to exist, I have to start asking these questions about sustainability and to meet the new like values. And then, of course, there's legislation coming. So, I mean, with Finland, there's 2035, we're supposed to be carbon neutral. You know, if we're serious about that, that's massive. And, you know, companies are going to have to, like, really pick up the slack and hit the ground running. And then so, of course, like companies like Vincit who do some consulting work, we're going to have to like help companies to do that. So we're going to have to like, you know, get them into a place where they can do their services and products sustainably. That's kind of our role.
All right. So let's start finally taking the planet seriously. And we can hear the round of applause from the one of the stages. And I guess it would have been the same applause to the idea. By the way, all the big festivals, all the big startup festivals are nowadays trying to be sustainable. Slush is not an exception, and Stream, of course, is not an exception. Speaking of Slush, what are your expectations here? What are your plans for these 2 days?
Well, I'm really hoping to actually talk to the media, because we want to get planet-centric design kind of out to the world. We don't want it to be something that is just a Vincit thing. Actually, like the toolkit that we have, we'll be open sourcing and trying to spread it as much as possible, get it in other designers' hands, because this isn't really like it's not a competitive sport, sustainability. It's a team sport, and we need to work together. But what I'm hoping to get out of Slush, well, I mean, I've already seen a few things that are a bit problematic from a sustainability point of view. You know, there's a few startups here who have got some new tech, a new product. And the question that I have is, you know, why? You know, you spent 4 years developing this thing. It's a new material, maybe, but like, do we need it? You know, is it? What's the purpose? And I think that that's still kind of prevalent here. Is the why question? You know, we can do something, but like, why are we doing it? So I think, you know, that there can be some sustainable processes here. There's like, you know, they'll recycle some of the materials, and you know, they've got some like vegan options for food. But it's really about kind of the activities going on here, and what's the why? You know, what's driving all the startups here? I think that's something that still needs to be worked on.
I really liked your thought that sustainability needs team. So you believe that there can be cooperation between startups within one topic?
Yeah, I really do. And actually, like, I'm hoping to. We have our launch event coming out coming next week. And, you know, I invited our quote-unquote competitors to come, because like